the same thing, but instead of the slope being a half, we get about 0.4. So we go to tensile strength of our aluminum, up to a tensile strength of about 320, something like that, 325. We can use our endurance limit, about 40% of the tensile strength in our design target. And then once we get up above an aluminum that has a higher tensile strength than 325, we use this sigma, this endurance limit. This ERB just means endurance limit, fully reversed, and bending. Okay, that's what the subscripts mean. So we can use this 130 megapascals as an endurance limit for any aluminum that has a tensile strength greater than 325 megapascals. And that's typically what we use in the design. Okay, so that's it for fully reversed. All these data are obtained using fully reversed loading, which you know has a mean stress of zero. We also indicated that if you have a non-zero mean stress, okay, adding baseline stresses around your cycling stresses, then you have a non-zero mean stress, it's more damaging to your material. Okay, so what you can see is as you increase the mean stress for a given stress amplitude, say 200 megapascals, so at 200 megapascals in our fully reversed, we have about a million cycles to failure. But if we increase our mean stress to 138 megapascals, we have less than 10 to the 6 cycles to failure, and we increase it to 276, even less. So our fatigue life is decreasing as we increase that mean stress. It's also interesting to note that compressive mean stress actually extends the life. It gives you some credits. But in your design, if you have a compressive mean stress, it's easier to just use the fully reversed effect and don't take the credit. You have a more conservative approach to that, so your safety factor gets bigger. So most of the time you see you don't even look at that credit for your compressive mean stress. Okay? So again, what was our, let's make sure we remember what our design equations are. Sigma A equals ANF to the B. Remember, this sigma A is our fully reversed stress amplitude, and A and B are fitting constants. We also have our Basquiat's equation. Stress amplitude is a materials constant, sigma F prime, times the quantity 2NF to the power of the little b. That's a materials constant. You can look those up in tables. So those are our design equations that we use to predict cycles to failure. Okay? But notice in those design equations, only the fully reversed stress amplitude is included there. So when we get to our mean stress effects again, we need to somehow feed those back into those stress life equations.
That's good.
Okay, those two equations we just looked at. Right? So we need to figure out how we're going to do that. This plot shows us the effect of the non-zero mean stresses. Another way to look at it is we look at a constant life diagram. In this case, we varied the stress amplitude and notice that the cycles to failure decreased. In this case, we're looking at stress amplitude versus the mean stress now, and what happens? Basically, it's the same trend that I just discussed in this one. As we vary the mean stress, the cycles to failure decreases. We can also say as we vary the cycles to failure, we can only put so much mean stress on it. It's basically the same plot, only instead of stress amplitude versus cycles to failure, we're putting stress amplitude versus mean stress. And now you can see we have this, what we call a constant life curve. So we can see what our sigma A versus sigma M combination does for a particular, how it changes for a particular targeted number of cycles to failure. Yeah.
So going back to compressive stresses, is that just because there's less axial dislocations in the material, or why
it's because, yes, it's because in tensile mean stress, stresses, okay, you have the crack opened up all the time. And the cycling opens it more, a little more each time. In compressive mean stresses, it takes the crack and it closes it a little bit. And so when you're opening it, you actually get less of a stress amplitude level, if you will. Okay? So you get that credit because it's all about crack propagation. And that's why chapter 11 is the most real part of this design, because it couples that fracture mechanics we learned in chapter 8 with the fatigue that we're talking about right now. And that's, again, that's the way everything fails in fatigue, is you get these cyclic stresses, and then eventually the cyclic stresses act on a crack, and the crack propagates and it fractures. Okay, so it's always a brittle fracture, kind of. Okay, sometimes it's a very ductile material. It's still crack propagation, but it propagates in a ductile fashion, but we still think about it as fracture mechanics. Okay, so we can see our constant life diagram. You can see over here with a mean stress of zero, okay, what does that mean? What does a mean stress of zero mean? What kind of loading?
Fully reversible.
Fully reverse loading. So if we just take a vertical line, we can see where our mean stress is zero, our fully reversed, our stress amplitude versus cycles of failure intersects all of these. If I took these and plotted them against these, I just have my standard stress life curve that I got my design, my already determined design equations that we talked about. Sigma A equals A and F to the B, or sigma A equals sigma F prime to N F to the B. That's what these points would tell us right there. But what we really need is we need, how does it affect when we don't have a mean stress of zero? Because that's reality. Rarely do you have a mean stress of zero in your designs. There's always some kind of a mean stress. So we gotta bring those into our equations, okay? So the best way to do that is to take the previous two plots and normalize our stress amplitude against that fully reversed stress amplitude. And this is your lab. Now, your lab assignment says to generate one of these curves. And why is it so important to be able to generate one of these curves? Well, this is where all of our design equations come from. So what we do is we normalize our stress amplitude against our fully reversed stress amplitude, okay? And then plot that against a changing mean stress. And what it does is it condenses all the data down to where there, we can draw trend lines through those data now. So it basically takes all of these data, and all of these data, and all of these data, and it squishes them down into one area where now we can plot some kind of trend line through those. And that's all we're doing for our design equation. So now we have our sigma A. Okay, we have our sigma A and our sigma AR involved with the mean stress. Some of these equations have material properties involved, okay? So why are we doing this? What's our end? What do we need to do to design two cycles to failure? What equations do we use that have cycles to failure in them?
Sigma A.
Sigma A equals what?
The constant.
Equals some constant times cycles to failure to the power of some other constant, right? We have another one. Sigma A equals sigma F prime to AF to the B, because this Basquine didn't like these guys' the equation. I think this one looks better, even though they're the same equation, okay? Because they're applying the same data. In fact, you can convert between these materials constants, there are equations to do that. He just was like me, he wanted his name in the textbooks, I guess, so he got it. Then this was from this guy, Basquine. I didn't even know that until I took that class from Mike Hill over there. But anyway, this one seems to be the most popular one. I don't know why, okay? But maybe because he has a cool name, I don't know. Except home, that probably wouldn't be. Anyway. So there you go. So those are our design equations. B Do you see cycle failure up there anywhere?
Where is it?
Well, okay, this means that the circles were generated without cycles to failure, but when you're using these design equations, are you going to extract cycles to failure out of those design equations? What do you extract out of here to get cycles to failure?
The AR.
Sigma AR. So what you're going to get is you're going to get an equivalent fully reversed stress amplitude, okay, from your sigma A, sigma M combination. So we have this reality where we have a sigma A, comma, sigma M combination, and we've got exactly sigma M, comma, sigma A coordinate pair, okay? And we take that and we calculate an equivalent sigma AR, and that goes in our equations. So that's the process. It's really simple if you keep yourself oriented. So this actually should say this, okay? Because these only use sigma AR, but you never see them like this in design textbooks and machine design. Okay. I don't know, you might. I don't know what it was in 117. What did it look like? You guys remember? Went too fast through fatigue?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah? Was that one of those right and raised at the same time? Anyway, so that's what we're doing here. I mean, this again, this is the meat of it. So what we're doing is we want to take some combination of the stress amplitude and the mean stress, and we want to predict how many cycles to failure. It will be different if this equals zero than if this does not equal zero. It'll be different, okay? Sigma M does not equal zero because a mean stress is more damaging. So we go to these plots right here and we use all these guys' equations, all these lucky guys, to say no mine's better, okay? And so we draw this normalized amplitude mean diagram, which you guys are doing for problem 931 in lab, okay? I don't know what you're supposed to draw in.
Excel, and then also for us, we had to create a transfer to MATLAB for the plot.
Good. That's what I was gonna ask you to do, so good. So it sounds like the last instructors are listening to me, which is amazing, okay? So you guys see what you're doing here? Okay, and look at all of our equations right here. Which equation is that? About the straight line, anybody know that equation?
Morrow.
Morrow, what's this one?
Goodman.
That's Goodman. Those are the ones you heard in 117, right? And what was your question? How do we know when to use which, right? Okay, well, guess what you're gonna do? If you don't know, you gotta use different ones and maybe use the most conservative, use the most conservative calculation. But you can see that your safe area is down here and your unsafe area is up here. Which one, according to these data, fits the best? Yeah, this guy looks like it fits the best. But this modified, what is this, the modified Goodman, I think?
That's
curve. I think that the curve is the modified Gerber. That's a Gerber parabola. Yeah, it's a Gerber parabola. You can see it's the one that would predict safest, so that's probably the most conservative, okay? But other data, I mean, this comes from this 7075 T6 aluminum, okay? Another material might be, you know, it might be way down here, or it might be over here, okay? So it depends on the material, which equation is gonna be the best suited for your design, okay? But the point here is a single curve representing the data allows fitting for design. So we have all these equations now. And this is where on some page in your Dowling book, he just starts throwing equations at you. He says, okay, here's where it starts. This is the straight line, this is the Goodman, okay? Here's the Gerber parabola, here's the Morrow, here's the SWT, here's the Walker. This one, turns out, is the one you probably should be using all the time, okay? And it's because the walker allows you to vary the exponent on your sigma max and your max stress and your stress amplitude, which of course speaks to the mean stress, right? Because your mean stress is your sigma max minus your sigma A, okay? So it's embedded in here, but it allows you to sort of manipulate your equation more precisely on your data fit for a specific material. So gamma becomes another material property. And if you look on Moodle, you'll see a couple of papers that Dowling published where he went in and he did all this testing, and there's tables and tables that he generated for this journal paper that he published of different values for gamma for different materials. And this is my buddy Mike Hill. This is what he uses all the time. He uses gamma. He uses the Walker equation because it seems to be more accurate for all the materials that he tests. All right? I don't remember how much of the homework involves the Walker equation. All of it should involve the Walker equation. But the book is old enough to where those papers that were published by Dowling, I think, came out about the same time that this, for the latest publishing of his book. And so he didn't, I think the next edition of his book is going to put more emphasis on this Walker equation actually in the text. So that's where this is going. Okay? But you can see what are you doing here. You got sigma AR, you have your stress amplitude, you have your mean stress. Sometimes this material property, the SWT equation, no material properties in there at all. That's why that one's kind of easy. Okay? Sometimes if you only know sigma AR, you have to iterate the values over here, but this one has your Bridgman fracture strength as a material property. How easy do you think it'd be to find that? Yeah, sometimes it is. Not for in Dowling it is, but for a lot of materials that's not tabulated. Tensile strength, that's why Goodman's so popular, because tensile strength is so readily available. Okay? Again, Gerber might be a little too conservative for some people, for some materials. In the end, of course, if you're using a weird material, you're going to have to test it yourself. So what do? We take our design equations and we rearrange it algebraically. We solve for sigma AR. Why do we want that? Well, because sigma AR is an equivalent, completely reversed stress amplitude with the sigma A, sigma M combination. And that's what our normalized amplitude mean diagram is doing for us. It's allowing us to calculate based on the trend lines in those different people's equations, allowing us to calculate sigma AR so we can take it back into our stress life equation and calculate and determine and predict number of cycles to failure. Okay? So here's the Goodman. Okay? Here's the Moore equation for steels. You'll notice when Dowling talks about these things, this one seems to work pretty good for these materials, you know, and it should, at the very end of every little caption, should say, it's fatigue, because you're constantly saying, how do I know which equation to use? For me, of course, I'm going to tell you which equation I want you to use. Okay, in your homework, you should be using multiple equations and seeing how your safety factors compare between the different equations. Okay? All right. What we can do is we can combine these design equations from our normalized amplitude mean diagrams into our target stress life equation, and now we have one equation. If we can say sigma AR equals 2N, sigma F prime times 2N F to the B, substitute that in, and now for the Moore equation, we have a single equation where we don't have to go through the steps. Does it all in one step, and that's what this is, our accommodate. I think this is 921 or 922, something like that, okay? So you can go directly to these with a sigma A, sigma M combination. Notice sigma AR is not in here because sigma AR is that times that, okay? So it's embedded in there with these, with the cycles to failure. Okay, Morrow equation, here's the SWT equation. You just substitute that in for sigma AR. Any of the stress equations can be similarly employed to generalize the stress-like equation, okay? So those are your generalized equations that you can go straight to. Now, make sure you know at what level you're using these equations. I have a lot of students who, on the exams that I give when they're calculating these things, will use this equation, the generalized equation, and then go back and use this equation again. Make sure you know what you're doing. Either use the generalized in one step or use the design equations that come off of the normalized amplitude mean diagram in one step and then these equations in the second step. But don't do both because it's not correct. Okay, let's see what else. Safety factors with mean stresses, kind of the same thing we do with other safety factors. Only now we're using an equivalent sigma AR on the curves to get our safety factors, okay? There is a nice modified equation from the Morrow where he actually put another factor in his equation that that actually weights the effect of either the stress amplitude or the mean stress. Okay, it's called the load factor approach. So what he did is he took his equation and went, I know it's really good, but we can make it even better if the value of sigma, the stress amplitude is, say, weighted more, if the change in the stress amplitude has a greater effect than a change in the mean stress, you can put a bigger weighting factor on the stress amplitude, and vice versa. Usually, if the mean stress has a more weighted effect, as you change that, you can put a weighting factor on this. And that's what that Y sub M is, okay? So, you're getting right down into the nitty-gritty of your design, you might want to do that because you're getting too much scatter in your data, and it's because you're not really thinking about superposing those two different effects between your mean stress and your stress amplitude. And that's what these load factors can do for you. And I think one of your homework problems, actually, as you look at that. Okay? So far, everything up to this point, how do we get all these data? How do we load it?
Axially?
Yeah, we use our fatigue tester, right? Or we use our fatigue tester with some kind of a mean stress somehow, okay? Fully reversed, where we get a fully reversed. It's basically uniaxial loading. Remember that, when you're bending it and we have a constant moment across that, it's uniaxial loading. We have that moment acting uniaxially. There's no transverse stresses or anything. But again, in reality, is that ever the case? Only when we're doing a tensile test, maybe, okay, or a bend test. But machines and everything else we design have multiaxial stresses. So now we need to bring in chapter 6 and chapter 7 into the fatigue that we're talking about. So if we look at, say, how a pressure vessel cycles, or if we have multiple loads on a pressure vessel, what we do is we take the effect and we superpose those things. Okay? So combine cyclic pressure and steady bending of a thin wall tube with closed ends. Okay? So notice we got a moment here, we're kind of bending this thing. And we're pressurizing it, okay? We're not spinning this thing. So from the pressure, we get zero to tension, okay? But from the bending, we get this, we get some kind of a mean stress. Notice MR over I and PR over 2T. What direction is this stress right here? Notice it says sigma 2. you can see our element right there. So we have sigma 1 doing this. Sigma 2 is also doing this, but we've got bending going on. Okay? So where is this? Where is this with respect to the bend? Where's this element right here? We're adding tensile stresses from the bending as a baseline stress. So how's this thing, how's this moment bending? It looks like it's bending from this vector. This is using that right-hand rule vector notation, it looks like. So the bend is this way, in and out of the board, isn't it? So it's bending like this kind of, right? That's what this says, right? You guys get this notation right here? Turns out if I didn't put this on my preliminary exam, if I didn't draw the free body diagram in my analysis, if I went straight to the element and did more circle, turns out I found out that's why I didn't pass the first time through on that preliminary exam. I knew what I was doing, but I was in front of the panel of judges, basically, these professors that wanted to ask me some questions. And I said, yeah, it was this combined stress beam. And then they wanted to know where the highest shear stresses were. And I jumped right in because I knew exactly where they were. And so I drew my element and they said, stop. And I said, okay. And they said, and I said, you don't want me to tell you. They go, no, you're not approaching this correctly. Okay. I don't know what you guys want. Well, if you don't know what you want, then see ya. And that's how my first oral exam went.
That wasn't last week, right?
No, that was 2 years ago. It wasn't last week. Luckily, I found this out before I went into this exam on Thursday. But anyway, what they wanted to see is they wanted me to cut the beam off of the support and draw as a free body diagram. They wanted to see these unknown forces, basically. Reaction forces. They wanted to actually see those. I'm like, why do you need those? Those are kind of, I'm telling you what they are without even drawing them. But anyway, so you can see if that moment vector is going straight up, it means it's spinning around that, so it's bending out of the plane of the screen that way. So that's where this, that's why this element in the longitudinal direction has that bending stress involved. If this element was taken from the top, this would just look like half of that, right? So you guys see why the amplitude in cycling here is half of that? You guys see that? Because the tangential pressure stress is twice the longitudinal pressure stress, okay? So your combined stress homework does this. So basically what you do is you just draw your element and you put what your cycling is doing on there. And now I have multiaxial stress as an element. Okay, it's not uniaxial. How about if we take this thing and we torque it? What happens to torsion on that element?
Shear.
Now I'm adding a shear, right? In this case, it's all normal stresses, right? If we're looking at this element, okay? But in this case, if I torque it, now I'm adding a tau xy, and you can see a TR over J. So now I have a PR over T, a PR over 2T, and what happens now, you can see that if I rotate this 45 degrees, then I have my normal stresses, okay? You can kind of see, we're bringing in all of our chapter 6 stuff. Where's our principal stresses? here's my sigma 1 and sigma 2, but now it's taking my normal stresses that I want to use in my equations now, okay, although some we use the shear, and it's actually, every time it cycles, it's rotating it like this, and you want to know what the peak of those rotations are. So your normal stresses are actually rotating with cycles. Okay, so now there's a lot going on here, even though it looks pretty simple. All I'm doing is pressurizing this thing and putting a torque on it. There's no bending on it. But there's a lot going on where the principal stresses occur. Okay? You guys see that? Alright. So, what do we need to do when we have multiaxial stresses? Well, we always need some type of an effective stress amplitude to take into our stress life equation. We need an effective sigma AR, okay? All right, so if we use the von Mises criterion, okay, which is our octahedral shear stress failure criterion, what we do is we do all of our analysis, we figure out what our principal stress amplitudes are now, not just principal stresses, but our principal stress amplitudes, and we feed them into von Mises equation right there. So you can recognize that as von Mises, right? Except instead of sigma 1, sigma 2, and sigma 3, we're using sigma 1a, meaning the principal stress amplitudes. So what's the principal stress amplitude right here? Could it be the peak amplitude here? It's half of it, right? Because remember, stress amplitude is half of your wave. So when you're doing this again, when you're doing these calculations, you gotta take half of your cycle, okay? Half of your stress range to get these stress amplitudes, okay? Now, if you want an equivalent mean stress for our generalized stress amplitude, so up here, no mean, maybe zero mean stress, but that's never the case. What we have to do is we have to say, you know, a mean stress is more damaging, so I need an equivalent mean stress if I have multi-axial mean stresses. And the way we assess the damage of that in order to take into our generalized stress life equation is we just add the three together, okay? But what do you do? Notice in here, because you're going to come up against this, you're going to see only tau xya and tau xym do not equal zero, so these equations simplify, okay? So that's problem 941 when we look at that, okay? Problem 941. So you're going to see that, what I mean by that, when you try that. Or I can take 15 minutes and explain it to you, but it'll take way less time once you try this.